Hi everyone.
Hi, Wendy.
I want to break free. I want to break free. I want to break free from your lies. Your soul tells that it's mine. I don't need you. I want to break free. I'm falling in love. I'm falling in love for the first time. This time I know it's for real. I'm falling in love. God knows I'm falling in love. It's strange, but it's life still goes on. I can't get used to it without you by my side.
Now that we've all broken free, welcome to Wicklow Music Generation again. Good afternoon, here we are again. It's Eileen live streaming from Wicklow, from the sunny southeast, or it could be called the sunny east coast. My name is Eileen and...
My name is Patrick. Welcome to day four of FET Fest, and it is Transformation Thursday. A special welcome to our FET colleagues all over Ireland and our international colleagues overseas.
Continuing the momentum from our three sessions this morning, transformation has played an integral part of education, training, and work life over the centuries.
This afternoon's session focuses on the elements of trust, thought, and task, and how it supports transformative potential, both in the workplace or education and training environments.
Recognizing the value of people's transformational journeys is essential to delivering best practice models in team building, knowledge and skills for both businesses and FET sector.
The presentation this afternoon will introduce the principles and pathways of both our presenters today. Having both travelled the hospitality route and a few other stops on the way,
I would like to introduce you to both our wonderful presenters today, Mary Jo Hoyne and Rishnoor. Kaur.
Mary Jo is a consultant for educational projects, taking them from concept innovation to high-performing schools. Key areas of focus are project management, transformational regeneration of colleges, universities and schools over the past 20 years.
Rishnoor specialises in change management, focused on transformative people management initiatives, and has been at the helm of several Irish chain hotels over the past 15 years, focusing on organisational culture change management during a time of flux for these businesses.
Welcome Mary Jo and Rishnoor, and over to you.
Go ahead, Mary Jo.
Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you so much for having me on FET Fest. And a big thank you to Eileen and to Patrick. And thank you, Patrick, for that introduction. It's a great pleasure to be here with you. I guess you're all probably looking at the slide right now and thinking, am I getting a talk? Are we getting a talk on construction this afternoon? And you might be forgiven for thinking that. Those pictures were actually taken from projects where I was fortunate enough to have been part of the change planning process that was happening before the schools and colleges were actually opening. So the buildings there, to a degree, they can transform the teaching and learning. But this session today is very much about how we as people transform and change those environments. You will see on the right-hand side there, there's the matrix, which is think to transform, and it's the trust, thought, and the task. And this is something that I formalised along the way, along my many journeys in education and through many projects. And it really is very much about putting people at the heart of what it is that we do. Taking you through very quickly then what we want to share with you in this session, I will start with the first couple of topics, and then Rishnoor will take over from me. So looking at education and skills change, set in the context of transformation, where we're at now, where we're going to, what the workforce in fact is looking like right now, and their needs moving into the future. Transformation happening through two examples that I've chosen for this session this afternoon, two very different examples, and we'll come to that shortly. Within those examples then, I will speak about what we went through from the time we conceived the idea, as it were, until it was actually rolled out in practice. So we'll talk through that matrix, we'll bring it alive there. Rishnoor will come in then, and she will share with everybody strategies from business and speak a little bit about the power of her own personal journey and the transformation that she's gone through and that she's still going through. And we'll explain to you how that's actually working in action in this new program that we're running for KWETB. And that's all about innovation in delivery, in educational delivery. Flexibility, the era of openness, and what's happening now. So we'll speak a little bit later about that. So here we have a quotation from a great educationalist who was very concerned with change and reform in his time. And I wonder if he came back today, what would he think of what we're doing now? He famously said, "If we teach today as we taught yesterday, we rob our children of tomorrow." So that's quite a loaded statement. But he was a huge fan of and believed in learning by doing. So applied learning and the application of learning. And it is here that in my own journey and my own career that I have seen what we call an acceleration of learning happening once the learning becomes applied. Now, later I'll discuss about that journey and what that can look like, but we have this or we and the people that I've worked with over the years have had this idea, obviously the lateral and the linear thinking. And it's only in the disruption of some of these thought processes that we can actually, I believe, and I have seen in the projects I've been doing, achieve great things. So let's look at the demands of today's workforce. And perhaps let's not just look at them today, but let's take them 5 to 7 years into the future. So we have to ask the question, and I'm going to ask quite a few questions throughout this presentation. Are we equipped with the skills to support the demand? Are we able to deliver a talent pipeline that matches the needs of these organizations? And will our children be fully equipped to avail of the opportunities of the future? Do we know what that future looks like? We're told, we've seen it in this last time that we've gone through. And I also made a promise that I would try and get through this presentation without actually speaking about COVID. So that's the only time I'm going to say the word. So look, do we know? Have we got the answers? What will it look like 5 to 7 years in? We are actually being shaped now, and we're being reshaped. And that's happening in a huge way. It's causing a huge shift in our society. We're living through times where we're actually becoming reordered as a consumer. So we are not the consumers that we were 18 months ago. We are different. And a young person in learning and teaching and learning and in education, and we as educators, are we the same people that we were before? Things have changed, things have flipped. You know, traveling around the world was probably one of the top things that many people were doing. But now we see education in a position where that's at the very top of what our lives are around about right now. You know, you think the whole nation went into making sourdough bread. You know, we all went into learning mode. So teaching and education is now a leader, and it's at a time of great opportunity. Another question is that we ask, what is happening now in education? Is it good? And if it is good, should we challenge ourselves and ask, is it good enough? We need to couch this question in the context of the currency that we're experiencing through the lens of the digital age. The evolution in employment opportunities is changing at a pace like never before. We are experiencing rapid skills obsolescence. Our skills are becoming outdated more and more quickly. The process by which they're outdating is extremely rapid. Digitalization itself is rapid, and the very rapid digitalization of sectors, notably amongst those is manufacturing. This is requiring new working practices to be adopted very, very quickly and with very timely implementation timeframes. So if we've got that pace of speed happening, say, for example, within manufacturing, are we having that same pace happening within skills training and education? Will skills delivery and education be reimagined to align with these new working practices? Are our schools part of that, and are they ready to feed into that process? Are we ready to change? Are we brave enough? And something that came to me when I was actually creating this presentation, and I thought about it, will we have our space nationally in this change transformation, but also in this digital age? And most importantly, will we be players on the global stage of change transformation in skills and education? So I'm going to move on now, and I'm going to share two examples, which I think are quite, they're good examples because they're different. They had factors and elements in common, but they're two different examples. So here we have, on the left-hand side, you can see 15 London there, and this was a highly transformational creative project that was set up for Jamie Oliver. And it was about getting unemployed young people, socially disadvantaged young people, back into employment. And then on the other side, you can see a college there, a very structured environment, very hierarchical, actually, as many of the colleges are. And this college, I came into that college at a time of, we'd just come out with a crash of 2008. And it was a very difficult time, and it was a time of great change, actually, within the organisation. Something, you know, happened, and that was finance. It was budgets. Budgets crashed, you know, after 2008. And we actually lost our entire adult budget and all our funding for the adult provision. Now, the two examples that I'm giving you, they both have commonality, as in, you know, rolling out both projects. They both required lots of drive and very high energy. They were very demanding. They required ultimate commitment, total commitment. They were all consuming projects. And when I say all consuming, you know, 16, 18 hours a day was the norm in these environments. We began to plan, we began to formulate our plans and our strategy, and we wanted to roll this out to create change in the different areas. And this was often across a landscape of multiple stakeholders. So it wasn't just, you know, dealing with the college, it was dealing with a whole host of stakeholders that supported the college, that were part of the very fabric of the whole provision, right through to the supply chain, to governors, to government itself. We looked, you know, at so many different areas, local community groups and so forth. And with the Jamie Oliver programme, we had vast amount of industry stakeholders there as well. We needed to be very, very resilient and very determined, and we had to draw upon these resources of resilience and determination on a daily basis. But for me, and for me after reflection, it's only when I actually came away from these projects and several years later that I reflected and deeply on what had happened at that particular time. And when I could share this with you now, I believe, and the teams that I worked with at the time, we're all in agreement that it was the thought processes that went into both of these projects that actually ultimately made them succeed. And when I talk about thought processes, you know, I mean, of course, our own thinking and our own thought processes, but it was the conception of the idea. So the conception of the very change itself, what would that look like? And how would that translate in operations to the point of the end delivery? So out of that, then I started to coin the matrix of the thought, the trust, and the task, ultimately leading into the transformation. So here you can see in front of you, we have this quadrant, and you see it there, the thought and the trust at the top. And in the center is conviction, and conviction, and then there's vision and mission. The matrix is a concept that's derived out of the previous examples, as I've said already. I used it to drive change in delivering the projects during times of high demand, which often involve multiple and sometimes conflicting priorities with many stakeholders. It's very high energy, it's very creative, and it's driven by performance excellence. It relies on people and on the innovation of our ideas and convictions. And just going back to the Jamie Oliver programme, you know, these socially disadvantaged 15 young people taken and transformed through skills education and training, and then transplanted, as it were, into five-star hotels in the West End of London, but not just in London, across the world. They actually went global after that programme was made. And that was actually, that was generated through the thought and the belief and the trust in the idea and in the people that were working together. These were young people who would never have been in these hotel environments or had come across these types of environments. And they were customer facing, and they were serving food and drink and offering a service to some of the most discerning clientele that you can imagine. And later, as I said, after leaving London, went to California, Australia, Asia, all over, and were a global success. And one of them is back here in Ireland today. And I could share that a little bit with you outside of this presentation. And I will send you this information and you can see, and I'll give you some more details on that. So let's move on now, and we'll move into a little bit more detail there. I'm not going to read all this out to you. It's there. It's if you look at the second paragraph, there's an important element to this thought process, which is the capacity to think forward. Okay, so we need to be able to think forward when we're designing these ideas and projects, and we need to be able to take full stock of where we're at currently and all the influencing factors that are actually around that. And the big thing is, are we thinking laterally when we do it at this particular point? I'm talking to educators in the room. I'm talking to potentially policy makers as well. I'm talking to a vast array of people. But I have to, say here, I have to say it. Do you trust yourself? And that might seem, why are you asking that? Well, it's only if you trust yourself that you're actually going to be brave enough to have the conviction of what it is that you're going to do. Do you have the conviction of thought around what you're rolling out? Is it embedded throughout the entire journey of change? And that's from policy making right through to delivery. And now, from my experience, having been involved with policy making and having been involved with end delivery, a huge amount of things happen from the time the policy is made, from the time it actually reaches the end user. So somewhere along that chain, we need to be looking at how that is bridged, how that's managed, and how that is maximized to actually transform what it is that we're doing, and transform our teaching and learning, and transform the lives of our learners. Some people might look at the organisation that they're working in. They might look at the culture. They might look at the people and the structures. And this is crucial now. We need to generate high levels of innovation, and that will be a marker in setting us apart for the future. At a more local level, we might be looking at the current job roles. We might be looking to elevate our delivery of the service that we offer. Or perhaps we're thinking that we can create a bridge to produce higher performing teams that would result in a culture of excellence. Whatever we decide, it will be our ability to change ourselves and those around us to be innovators and creators of our future. We need to harness our unique abilities and set ourselves apart as the drivers of change. We need to be those change agents and not wait to be changed. Okay, and we can do that through this matrix. We need to have strength and confidence in those ideas, and we need to have full conviction of the vision and the mission. We also need to allow time as this evolves. We need to look at it holistically. We need to grow it quite organically, and we need it to be a very transparent process. So I'm going to stop talking now, and I'm going to interject this matrix with a short video. I think it's not even 4 minutes long, and it's very, in my opinion, inspirational. It takes us and makes us think about the speed at which change is happening. And then we'll come out of that video and we'll go into the final element of the matrix, which is the trust. And then I'll introduce Rishnoor to you and we'll move into the task. So we'll have gone on that journey from the thought process through to the task.
Once upon a time, business as usual was often good enough. No, where we are going, good is dead. In a world where everything is connected, where everything is equally excellent, where performance is reaching perfection, there's only one space left to innovate in, you. Right now, you are a central point in the raging tornado which fueled by digitization, machine augmentation, disintermediation, automation, well, the list goes on. Science fiction is becoming science fact. Think about cars or computers that can learn and think. The way we work will never be the same. The skills we need will be driven. Winning or losing are now happening far ever before. So what's, how will you discover opportunities in one of the most transformational times in human history? Are you driving change or being driven by it? Action has become the new normal. Change is always gradually, then suddenly, well, really have stopped happening gradually. This change is exponential. Everything that used to be dumb and disconnected is now wired in cars, cities, ports, farms, even our bodies with sensors, and will talk to each other. And changes are also combinatorial, amplify each other, creating a perfect storm of change. Quantum computing fuels big data, the internet of things, artificial intelligence, and which fields. However, anything that digitized or automated will become extremely valuable. Human-only traits such as creativity, imagination, emotion, and ethics more important in the future, because machines are very good at simulating, but at being. Yeah, software will do some of our work, but this will focus on things that cannot be automated. To imagine change squared, got to start engaging more with what might be, with what is. Immerse yourself in the immediate 3 to 7 years out from today. We need to go beyond technology and data to reach human insights and wisdom. Technology represents the how of change, but humans represent the why. The future is about holistic business model. The opportunity is to be liquid, to learn just in time, not just in case. Not single improvements, but complete transformations. Not individual systems, but new ecosystems. Humanity is where true and lasting value is created. We will engage, relate, and buy things because of the experiences they provide, because of their transformative power. The future doesn't just happen, the future gets happened. The new way to work is to embrace technology, but not to become it. The future isn't technology, yet the bigger future lies in transcending it. Let's live and lead from here.
So I hope you enjoyed that. I found it wonderful to listen to it in terms of hold on to our humanity. And I think that's something that we can't underestimate moving forward in this time of change, in this time of digitalization, where we're constantly bombarded in many ways by this the march of technology. So we harness the technology, but we manage the technology, and we allow our humanity and our ability to be the thought leaders of transformation, and we combine that with trust. And on your screens there, you can see, you know, all the different aspects that go into this. But in the center of the quadrant there, what makes you trust someone? What makes you trust somebody? The definition of trust above it there, the firm belief in the reliability, the truth or ability of someone or something. So in our educational system, have we got the firm belief in its reliability, in its truth, and in its ability, but in its ability to generate the change that we need to take us through the next 5 to 10 years. So let us move forward then based on our unique insights, as these set us apart as the innovators and as the change agents. Let us be brave enough to take others with us, and let us make the future transformative. There's a couple of thoughts there that I'm going to leave you with on that final slide before I hand you over to my co-host, Rishnoor. I just say to you there, have a look at using trust to mitigate any risk. And that's something that we did very successfully with the two programs that the examples I gave you earlier. It goes without saying, don't betray another's trust, be unfailing in maintaining that, and admit faults along the way. We're all human, we all learn from each other, and be transparent in that. Roll out the project on trust and use this to increase the execution and to accelerate the delivery of the task. And what do I mean by that? Well, I mean the teams that I've worked with in the past, we were all so secure and confident in what it was that we did, that we knew that we had each other's back no matter what. And that set us up for some fantastic journeys that we went on together. So I'll hand over now. Rishnoor is going to speak, and I come back to you at the end of the presentation when I'll speak a little bit on the last slide or so about what's happening now with KWETB with the two new leadership programs that are transforming hospitality at the moment and supporting our general managers as they go back in and open the industry.
Rishnoor, welcome. You're on mute there, Rishnoor, I think. Just getting your PowerPoint up for you. There you go.
Sorry, everybody, for the slight delay. My microphone was on mute, but I hope you can all see me now and hear me. Thank you for the wait. I'm absolutely delighted to be presenting here today with Mary Jo. It is a great honor and a privilege. Well, what a fantastic conference this has been so far. I've heard some of the presenters already. The ideas, the thoughts they have been sharing have been innovative, have been so useful, even for me, an industry professional up till recently. It has been just phenomenal to hear everybody. And leading in from what Mary Jo was saying about the focus being on humanity transformation all about humanity, I want to lead in with this short video and then we'll have a little conversation around the task involved in transforming organizations and my lived experience of it. So please join me in watching this short video. It's about 3 minutes long.
Opportunity is there if you're prepared to take advantage of it. There are thousands of occupations awaiting the workers who are qualified to fill them.
Survival is going to go not to the strongest or the most intelligent, but the most adaptable.
There are tests which will help you choose work which fits your level of capacity best.
Almost all jobs are becoming technology jobs.
We have to be more intentional about how training and education matches to actual tasks and jobs.
Many people today are working at things which were their hobbies a few years ago.
For the first time, literally, substantial and rapidly growing numbers of people will have choice.
We have to be aware of two things that are happening right now in the world of work. The first, we're realizing we're in for a much different kind of future, and we're racing to figure out how we can help individuals and businesses get ready. The second, we're starting to become highly aware that the more you push one narrow metric of success, money, growth, profit, at the expense of other life factors, the further we get from actually achieving true sustainable success. So we know the future of work will be different, and we can't keep doing things the same old way. A new way of work needs to emerge. 89% of the companies that were on the Fortune 500 list in 1955 are no longer on the list today. These are the businesses that had the most resources, the most talent, the greatest technology, the biggest network, and we've proven they rise and fall fast.
This really is the end of an era. Blockbuster will close all of its remaining stores, about 300 of them, by early January.
Well, what went wrong with Kodak? How could it have gone wrong?
It's so hard to keep up with change, and change is speeding up. So what's the next few decades gonna look like? Whether you're running a business or just running your life, that question is essential. In the last few decades, there was a shift of mind that started to define business success as one thing, money. This isn't my opinion. We can see evidence of this mindset. And the question is, has this singular focus worked out for people? Has it worked out for businesses? There's good reason to believe it hasn't. It's taken us time to understand our mistake and let it sink in. The old pursuit of work is not what's fully needed for the future. So then what is the answer? What are the real drivers of tomorrow's success, not just in business, but in life? Here's the thing. The new version of work, yes, it will be about technology, but it will also be about being human. Are you able to offer your highest potential? Can you keep learning, keep getting better? Stay motivated, stay focused. The best advances in tech and the best capabilities of people coming together, that is the new version of work. Self-awareness, creativity, empathy, trust. These factors will help define your future success. We place a lot of faith in the ability for technology to make things better. My faith is also in people.
So just like in the video, the best of tech and people coming together, our faith in humanity, our faith in our own abilities, our faith in our ability to transform ourselves, leave alone the business for a moment. That is what I actually am passionate about. That is what I believe in. My most recent industry role called on me to transform a hotel business in Kildare, as it happens. The business had not been meeting its KPIs for many years. It had been a business that had been the beacon of the local community about 15 years ago. And at that time, it had been under the ownership of a local family. But unfortunately, during the recession, it went to NAMA, and soon its glory days were behind it. Following my appointment there, for the first 3 months, my sole focus was on the 165 people. I firmly believed that a transformation of the culture of the business was where we needed to focus on, and everything else would follow suit. So I met with all 165 employees. I listened to them. I tried to gauge what their thoughts were on where the business was at, and equally, where were they in their own career journeys? For all the educators in the audience, my aim was a simple one. It was to educate myself so that eventually I could bring appropriate education to them all. Training and education in a form that was palatable to all of them, because my aim was to engage all of them, every single one of them. The hospitality industry has certainly been hit hard during this pandemic. But even before then, and for a long time now, it has been extremely challenging to recruit and retain people in our industry. So through many meetings, many conversations with not just the employees within the business, but with all various stakeholder groupings, I gathered critical knowledge about what was important to all these different groups of people. The groupings included investors, C-suite executives, our local executive team on the ground, obviously our employees, but equally our suppliers, and very importantly, our local community. If you recall, I just mentioned, this business had been a beacon of the local community for about 15 years ago. It was their pride, it was their place to be. And it was important to us that that is what it became once again. So listening to the community, engaging with the community, understanding what drove their interests was important to us. So in collaboration with my senior team, we engaged an external executive coach to help us identify our core values, the core behaviors that we believed would deliver the culture we and all of our stakeholder groupings would like to see within this organization. We also identified the key areas we needed to improve on so that people within the organization could sense change taking place. We spoke openly to a majority of them. We spoke often and we engaged with them. We told them what we were doing and why we were doing it. We wanted them really to be curious about what was going on. We wanted them to join in the journey. We wanted them to buy into the change. Eventually, we started meeting formally through town hall meetings, but we continued our informal discussions too. We discussed where we were headed, why we were headed in that direction. We asked them to share with us without hesitation what their concerns were. And equally, we challenged them to come up with solutions for these concerns, to engage with us, to hold us responsible in helping them find these solutions for the concerns that they had with the change that was coming. Once we started walking the talk, the sense of change really started being felt. So now it was time to introduce some element of this change into all of their day-to-day schedules. And you can imagine that was no fun bit of exercise. That was tough going. So by chance, one afternoon, in our busy carvery, I chanced about Eileen. She was there enjoying a spot of lunch. I introduced myself and a conversation followed. I shared with Eileen what I was doing in the business. Eileen told me about her journey with KWETB and what she was working on. And she followed on by saying, well, actually, I might reach out to you in a week or so. There may be something that we can work on together. Well, if any of you know Eileen, you know she's a woman who follows through. And a week later, Eileen, Patrick, and I met, and it was the beginning of what I see as another transformational journey, a transformation within a transformation, if you will. I described how I could not find any suitable training that would instill in my team the emotional intelligence to perceive guests' needs. My team were a collection of young people who are used to engaging with others via their mobiles and emojis. And I needed to teach them to communicate without shyness with people in person and let their personality shine through. Now, from having met all of them over the last several months, I knew that these people had a bright spark. They were passionate about various matters. When you got them going, when you engaged with them, they were happy to share their ideas. But somehow they were not used to or not comfortable in that one-to-one discussion forum when it came to essentially our guests who were strangers to them. I needed them to engage at a personal level with these guests. I needed them to make eye contact with them. So Eileen and Patrick took that away. And a while later, they both created and delivered for us a bespoke program. This was around the middle of 2019. And by October 2019, the transformation was so huge that this business was now meeting all of its KPIs. It had gone from being the lowest ranked within the comp set on TripAdvisor to becoming the top ranked hotel in the local area within its comp set. And all our guests who engaged with us on that platform told us that the key thing that they had noticed was the friendliness and the engagement they were getting from our team members. Well, now, if that isn't transformation, I don't know what is. But we couldn't stop there. To keep the momentum going, we had to keep the spark alive. In fact, we needed to fuel the spark and make it into a fire. So I introduced soon after that another program for our employees. And the program focused on improving engagement even way before these people chose to become are part of our organization. So we looked at how we were advertising, what engagement was that advertising for vacancies creating, what the journey eventually of these people who might end up joining the organization might look like. So I created a new appraisals and assessment program. Once again, I happened to mention this to Eileen in some conversation we had sometime during the year. And lo and behold, she had come up with another plan. What was important to us as an organization during that time was to engage our local community. It was extremely important to get their vision for the business inculcated within the business, because that would help us maintain this transformation and give it longevity. So the idea was that we want to engage with people within the community, may it be young adults or students, so that their first port of call when they went looking for work experience during their summer breaks or after finishing school would be this particular hotel, that there would be nothing else that they would look out for. They would seek out this business, that it would be a matter of pride for them and their parents and their extended families that they were part of this business, and that our local community would in fact support the business because we were supporting them and their children. So again, I knocked on Eileen's door and she introduced me to Sullis and Sidian Guilds and to the Global Hospitality Certification Program. But just as we started on this program, the pandemic hit, and it was critical that all parties involved were flexible. Otherwise, there was no way we could have continued on with it. But with collaboration, with flexibility, and all-round support, we made gradual progress. And in March this year, KWETB, City and Guilds, and Sullis helped us help this particular business become the very first hotel in Ireland to get corporate global hospitality certification for all qualifying employees. All during this time, as it happened, without realization, and then with some realization eventually, I was undergoing my own personal transformation. I had realized that I was very passionate about developing leaders for the future. I supposed to do my bit to future-proof the industry. I loved the engagement with all my team members. I had in fact been delivering courses with content that I'd created for several years within the workplace. But during the pandemic, I was doing this more and more. And I came to the realization that it had now become a calling for me. So I decided to take the leap. While I was still working this out, I happened to be speaking with Eileen and I mentioned something along these lines to her. And I have to say, by now you've heard me mention Eileen a good few times, but I'm a firm believer that sometimes in our life's journey, small conversations with some people can lead to big transformation for us individually. This is what happened. And over the course of the next few months, the program that I'm now delivering in tandem with Mary Jo was introduced. And I was lucky enough to be called upon to deliver that program. What you see on screen in front of you now is actually a QR code. So I would encourage you to scan it or take a screen grab of it. It is a TED talk that was delivered by Sir Ken Robinson, the ever eloquent Sir Ken Robinson. And he's talking here in this particular TED talk about not to talk really about education reform, but to focus our energy and our collective energies on education revolution. I found this particular video very inspiring, and I think certainly with the support of our Minister Simon Harris, whom I heard earlier this week open up the FET Fest, I think we are in for that journey now. So it's very, very prescient even today, though this TED Talk was first aired in 2010. So please take a moment, either scan this particular QR code or take a screen grab and you can watch it later. So I was mentioning just a few moments ago that I took the leap with support from close friends, close colleagues, Eileen and KWETB and Mary Jo, in tandem with Mary Jo, and we started delivering this really innovative program, the national launch of which was led by KWETB. The program is called Developing Leaders for Hospitality and Tourism. It was launched by the minister a few months ago, and now Mary Jo and I together deliver this program. The program is designed with flexibility inbuilt because the engagement from industry and the key learner groupings very much emphasized that they wanted the course to be flexible. They wanted a program where they could earn while they learned. The content is very varied. We have some theory that we deliver online. We have videos. There are team chats. We also have discussion groups and peer-to-peer learning. So the delivery can be very, very dynamic. We can start online, learners might engage with the videos while one of us is delivering content, the other engages the learners through chats on either their WhatsApp learners group or through MS Teams. We bring content that is there online, either videos, quizzes, different reports that may be prescient at the time. Equally, we encourage our learners to share relevant content with all of us. And that generates a lot of discussion, a lot of participation. And I have to say, so far, and I know I speak for Mary Jo when I say this, it is not just, I think, the learners who are getting benefit from this particular course and the way it is run, but even us, we enjoy delivering the way we deliver. The content can be so varied. Sometimes discussion groups can take a whole life of their own with one of our learners sharing something that they have come across. And it is hugely engaging for all of us. Equally, the program delivery is actually stopped during peak months for the industry. And at that stage, the learning focuses on the workplace. And Mary Jo and I then visit the businesses, obviously regulations permitting, and help our learners remain engaged and discuss with them what learning they've had and how they're supporting this for themselves. So with that, I'm going to hand you over back to Mary Jo for a few minutes. After that, after the presentation is over, we will remain online to address any questions you may have for us or anything you'd like to discuss with us. Thank you so much. Mary Jo, back over to you.
So thank you so much for that, Rishnoor. It's wonderful to hear you describing that level of engagement and collaboration with the learners and that enjoyment that we've actually got from the whole process. And that for me has been transformational. So thank you for sharing that so well. I know we've got some video clips coming up that were put together by a couple of the learners. We have a level 5 program and a level 6 program, leadership and management there. So I think without any further ado, we'll probably go into those testimonials now.
Thank you for bearing with us for a second, just while Mary Jo gets the videos open.
Rishnoor, could you play them directly from your screen there? Would that be possible?
Yes, of course, sure.
Thank you. That's lovely. Thanks.
Hi, my name is Keith, and I currently follow the CTN Guild's Diploma in Hospitality Supervision Level 5, run by the KWETV and delivered by Mary Jo Hoyne and Rishnoor. I'd like to tell you about this course because it has helped me personally make massive changes in my workplace, because the course structure is delivered in such a way that it's industry relevant. Every single aspect, all the units that is covered, you can use it in the entire hospitality and tourism industry. The course is just not delivered where the lecturer will speak and you just sit back and relax. There is a lot of interactive there's a lot of Q&A sessions, there are group discussions, there's a lot of activities, there's a few projects that you need to complete, there are assessment criteria that you need to be met. So there's a lot of information that you can get from.
I'm just wondering, ladies, is there any chance we could have a link to share that clip?
And I would also like to say about...
Yeah, sure, we can share that, yeah, no worries.
So it's not going to, you don't have to take time off and stuff like that. But let's say you don't get a chance to attend the course. There is always a recording of that day's session, so you can always revert back to it. And there is a WhatsApp group. If you've got questions, you can discuss with your colleagues, or you can call them personally and have a one-to-one session. There's a lot of encouragement, there's a lot of mentorship, and I strongly urge if anyone gets a chance to go ahead with this, because it has helped me, and I'm most certain that it's going to help you.
I am Fiona Smith, and I'm currently participating in the Level 6 Diploma in Hospitality Management. We're halfway through the course now, and I'm thoroughly enjoying it. The flexible teaching approach and interactive style of delivery works really well, and we have a mixture of lectures and group work, which also ensures that you get to learn from the other students in the group, which I'm finding invaluable. The industry relevant content is great, and we've had a wide range of very interesting guest speakers. The course is a big commitment, but for me to be able to earn and learn is a fantastic opportunity. I've already seen the transformation in myself and bringing what I've learned on the course back into the workplace, and I've received feedback already from my colleagues and my manager with regard to my motivation and enthusiasm since starting the course, which is all great. So thanks very much, and I look forward to the remaining few months.
Hello. This course is a very interesting and valuable experience for me to get a better understanding about the industry. It personally helped me to reevaluate my personal development plan and boosted me as a catalyst. I liked how it enabled me to interact with people through practical work and improve my people management skills. A special mention to my tutors, Mary Jo and Rishnoor, who are always happy to share their experience and knowledge with all our students anytime.
Hi, my name is Liz Birmingham. I'm the front office manager here at the Wooden Bridge Hotel and Lodge in Villavoca. We're the oldest hotel in Ireland. And I'm on here today just to let you know about the Level 5 City and Gales course through the Hospitality and KWATV. The reason for this video today is to highlight the advantages of undertaking this course. We have two new receptions being trained up at the moment in the hotel, and through the workings and through the training of the SOPs, what I have developed now is an in-depth training manual for the guys, and this has proved really good and really helpful to everybody. Our most senior receptions have actually commented on how good and how efficient the training has been to this. So for that alone, I would like to thank KWETB and City and Gales for this training, because it has really proved beneficial to the hotel and to us at Front House, making us more beneficial.
That's a fantastic way to end this session, with great positive feedback from all our FET learners after obviously being on these courses for the last few months, like all our other FET learners in all ETB land, and all the positive feedback that we receive. Now we're running out of time. Patrick, over to you just for a minute. There are questions coming in. There's a lot of questions. Can you maybe just give us a flavour of what they're asking?
Yeah, there's questions around technology and how the impact of technology on the way that we're obviously delivering. There are questions about human sort of capital within business. It's a shame that we don't have the time to cover those.
Unfortunately, we don't, because we have another session just straight after this. But I suppose, look, from my own perspective, transformation, I've been transformed over the last few days with all this fantastic work that's been going on with all of us and all of the ETBs and all the stakeholders. What about yourself, Patrick?
Yeah, 100%. It's been fantastic following FET Fest and all of the insights that we're able pick up from it. So fairly positive.
This is what we do best. We transform lives and we transform everyone that comes into our centres, into our schools. It's from the cradle to the grave. And that's why we are so unique. So without further ado, it's goodbye from him.
And goodbye from her.
Thank you. See you tomorrow, guys.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.